Jamila. How are you?
I'm doing great, Ahmed. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you for coming to the show. This is really a great opportunity to get to know you and know your story.
I appreciate that. I'm excited to share.
Awesome. Thank you. So, like all episodes, I'll start with a quote. I was taught that the way of progress was neither swift nor easy. Marie Curie, science is a universal language that transcends borders and brings people together in the pursuit of knowledge. Huda Zoghbi. So my first question is, can you tell us about your early life growing up in Los Angeles and how your parents' professions influenced your academic interest?
Sure, absolutely. I love the second quote. I think that's definitely been a driving force for me early on from my life. I was born and raised in Los Angeles. My parents migrated from Pakistan when they were in the 70s. And my mother is a physician and my dad's an engineer. And so academics was always very highly valued in my home, in my culture. And I think early on, you know, those dinner table math questions like really stuck with me and something I think I strive to do with my own children too. You know, the pursuit of knowledge has always been really important in my family and in my home.
Who was asking the questions, your mom or dad?
Always my dad. My mother hated it. My mother hated it. And she would be like, why can't we talk about other things at the dinner
table?
That's
awesome.
But it was a competition, you know, it was probably a competition between me and my brothers. Really enjoyed that.
That's awesome. I had seen an interview before people talk about how conversation at the dinner table shaped the relationship. So would you say, like, your relationship with your parents, because they were both in academia, was basically academic, and it was that this is the fun and part of it was learning from them?
Absolutely, though I wouldn't necessarily say my parents were academics. My dad was an engineer by trade, and I think at some point became an entrepreneur. At some point during my early life, which I couldn't tell you what day that was, but he became an entrepreneur from there moving forward, and my mom was a physician, you know, still to this day. Yeah.
Have you, I'm sure you have, like you probably went with her to work sometimes.
Absolutely. I've done the filing. Yeah. I've done all of those things that, you know, whatever a teenager could do at a pediatrician's practice, I have done. But I think it was those questions that my dad posed to me that really sparked some of that foundational curious way of thinking, the logical way of thinking that, you know, helped me to this day in my career.
That's amazing. Do you try to do that with your kids?
Yes, but I wouldn't say that we all enjoy it the same. I think back to that time, and I understand why my mom would be like, why are you doing this right now at the dinner table? Yeah. You know, sometimes we just want some quiet conversation about the day.
So thinking about how the culture and diverse background actually is in the heart of innovation, I remember an American scientist from a Japanese background, he said the strongest weapon the U.S. has is H-1B, which is the visa that allows people to come to this country. And I always in my mind is, how do I give, like I moved to the U.S. A while back, and I always think about my son. Do you think there is a relationship between speaking one, two, or three languages coming from different backgrounds in terms of the motivation that makes you excel in your career? Can we copy to our kids? How do you think about that?
You know, that's a great question. So my parents were immigrants. I was born and raised here. My husband, he was born in Canada. So we're both, you know, came from Western roots, if you will. Yeah. And we think about that a lot. What was it that helped us excel in our careers today? Mm-hmm. And I think a big part of what helped us was multiple languages, multiple cultures. We understood different ways of looking at the same, you know, model, the same thing. My parents are from Pakistan. My husband's parents are from Africa and India. We're both Muslims. And, you know, existing in this country, with somebody that looks like me and dresses like me and, you know, all of those things, yeah. You have to have a different perspective. Like, I bring a different perspective.
Absolutely.
I know that. And you bring a different perspective. Your children will bring their own unique perspective. And I think that's what's the most exciting part about innovation across the board, regardless of what it is that you're thinking about. Mm-hmm. Because without that, how can you solve a problem unless you have folks from different perspectives answering it, solving it? And I think that's really been something that has helped me excel in my career, is bringing my unique perspective from my background. And I hope that your son can do the same.
Yeah, absolutely. It reminded me of something I read this morning. Kai McCall, she used to work, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, BP, and now she runs the Renewable Alliance in Houston. And she wrote in LinkedIn saying, I promoted someone one day because they challenged me. And you don't see that everywhere.
Yeah.
And I really love the idea of Houston as a city having this diverse background of people from all over walks of life, because every different angle and perspective matters. And especially when it comes to sustainability and climate change, which we're going to touch later on, because we need everybody,
absolutely,
everywhere to tackle this issue, because it is a global issue, and we want to leave this earth better place for our grandkids, because they deserve something at least similar to what we had. So my next question, you mentioned through the conversation, you weren't always this energetic person, right? So, I mean, lacking social skills in your early life, can you share how you overcame that challenge?
Yeah, absolutely. Yes, I don't know that I would have ever agreed to do something like this at any earlier point in my life than today. Growing up, you know, I was definitely the bookworm, very academic. I didn't have a lot of friends. I didn't spend a lot of time outside of my home, outside of with my family, outside of my small friend circle. But as I grew up, I realized that some of these skills that I had built slowly, not unknowingly, at the dinner table were like really valuable, not just to me, but to some of the problems that existed in the world, to companies, to people, just broadly. And I think maybe sometime in college, that many years later, 18 or 20 years later, I started gaining some confidence around what I had to offer, what the unique perspective that I brought had value. And I think early on, when you lack social skills, when you lack that confidence, it's a belief that what I have isn't special, or what I have isn't valuable. Mm. And when you recognize that what you do have is special, it's not just because, you know, it's you and, oh, my daughter's so special. No, not like that. Every person's unique background, their experiences really build what they bring to the table, what they have to offer. Mm. And the moment that I realized that was when I think I gained that confidence and then could agree to do something like this.
That's amazing. I think there's a thrill in doing something new. And it's a pattern in your career that you started high and you moved higher and you moved higher. And this is important because I believe you broke so many glass ceilings. I think a lot of folks will look at you and say, you know, hard work pays off. Soft skills, you talked about picking up at the dinner table or whatnot, it's the blocks that you put together. The more you get skills, you reach to that breaking point where confidence happens. And I appreciate you sharing all of this, because I know it's hard, because it reminds you of the tough times you had to go
for
through.
Sure.
But I want to touch on something, which is having humility and feeling okay with making mistakes. How these two, you dealt with these two, reaching to that breaking point of saying, I actually have the confidence to move forward.
When I was in graduate school, there's this saying that every student in graduate school, especially PhD students, we have imposter syndrome. We think we got here by mistake. Somebody made an error on that application and accidentally admitted you. Obviously, that's not what happens. But I think kind of feeling that imposter syndrome, it is somewhat, it's where this idea of humility and confidence starts. It's a recognition that I don't know everything. I don't need to know everything. But I have the tools and the skills that I have to have that conversation with you, to learn about what I need to learn. And I think accepting that I don't know everything is a necessary step for anybody to excel, especially in climate and sustainability. We do not have all the answers anywhere globally. And so for me, I think understand, like, that balance, you know, confidence didn't mean I had all the answers, I was the smartest, I knew everything. It meant that I was sure of what I knew, and I was interested in sharing that and learning from others, from their experiences, from their knowledge, from what they had to offer. I want to, you refer back to something you mentioned, that you think that I have broken a lot of glass ceilings. I do not feel that way. I think I have been very fortunate in where I started, with the tools that I was given, with a very supportive family structure, with a very supportive parents, siblings, my husband, the family that I married into. They have all been so critical in the what I have achieved to date. But I don't think that I've broken necessarily any glass ceilings. I wouldn't necessarily call it that, I guess.
Maybe, you know, what you broke was a work that you really enjoyed. You did not feel like you're breaking, and maybe this is like a critical part. Yeah. Now, with the saying that, the difficulties, which we're going to talk about some moving forward, it's not all fun, right? There was obstacles, there was things you have to overcome, whether it's internal or external, meaning conflicts within or pressure from the outside. Now, were you a curious person?
You know, I've always been someone who likes to know the answer, but I don't know that I've always liked the journey to figure out the answer.
Interesting.
And I would say that's something that's followed me today. My husband and I joke all the time that I have a to-do list. I don't enjoy the process of crossing things off. I just want to see the to-do list crossed off. And it's something I still work on today. It's not about completing anything. Even this journey that I'm on today, it's not about all the things that I did and all the things I have done. But, you know, what did I learn along the way? What impact did I make across each of those things to myself, to my family, hopefully globally? And so, yeah, curiosity is one of those strange ones, because it's something that you should really want, right? You want to know. The pursuit of knowledge is exciting and interesting, and you learn so many things along the way. But it's not just about that last thing you learn that's useful to you.
This is related to your early journey when you graduated from high school and you went to UCLA. So you are at UCLA, which is, people call it the Ivy League of public schools. But you were at LA with your parents, right? So describe how undergrad, because I want to compare to what comes after moving to Boston,
sure,
all this big change, right? How was UCLA experience?
At UCLA, I lived at home during college. So I would say in many ways still an extension of my secondary education. Mm-hmm. Because I was still at home, but it was a place where all of a sudden, all those tools, all that skills, all that learning was valuable. And that was the first time I think I experienced where education, where academics had value to me, gave me value to myself. I think earlier on in my career, especially in high school, you know, at those times, it's not cool to be smart. Yeah. You know, you always hear that. And you know, I don't think I understood what that meant until I got to college. And then I realized, you know, all those things that I mentioned earlier, the background that I brought, the experience that I brought, the knowledge that I had amassed had value now. And I'd hate to say that because it had value to others, it gave value to myself. But I think it was a recognition, like I said, that what I do bring to the table is special. And it was a moment where I understood what that meant. And moving forward, I no longer needed that external validation anymore, because I had already understood for myself what it is that I brought.
I feel like the experience between public and private schools are different.
For sure.
Especially for the amount of students, right?
Yes, so very.
My undergrad had 40,000 graduates in 1 year, so students in 1 year. So looking at the experience of going to a large public school like UCLA, how was the experience in terms of having so many students in all the classes, big college? Was it different than private school coming after even graduate school?
Oh, yeah. I mean, absolutely. Public school is so different from what private universities have to offer. There's just not as many resources. Like you said, there are thousands and thousands of students. You are a number. That being said, I think it really pushes you to be the best.
I
best
agree.
That you can be. And there's something for everybody. think in a private universities, many of them are meant to be specialized, some cases.
Yes.
At a huge university like UCLA, there is something for literally everyone. There are people for everyone, there are organizations for everyone, there are classes for everyone. And I think that's what's really special about it. I will also add that I graduated college with no debt, and that was so valuable to me. Not that my parents probably would have ever allowed me to carry that on with me, but I recognize the value of that education now. After having been to a couple of private universities, I know what value a public education had for me.
That's amazing. The experience you had at UCLA, it was the beginning of what becomes you moving to Boston.
Yeah.
So could you walk us through the pivotal moment in your life when you finally moved away from your family, from your home, to a new city, or from West Coast to East Coast? And how was the master's degree at MIT experience like?
So as I mentioned, I lived at home during college. So I think some of that personal growth that people have when they leave home, that was a little delayed for me. I waited, I think, a little bit longer until I was ready to leave. And I pursued chemical engineering in school. And my dad kind of always wanted me to be a physician. That was always part of the plan. You know, Jamila's going to go to med school. She's going to be a doctor. And he kind of gave me a challenge. And he told me, Jamila, if you get into MIT, I will not tell you to ever go to medical school again. Like, you pursue engineering. You pursue what you're good at. And I'll drop the med school thing. I applied. I did not have any hope at that time that that would happen for me. But, you know.
Did you want it to happen?
I wanted it to happen. I knew what I was good at. You know, okay. I knew I'm analytical. I knew that this type of work is where my skills, like, come really shine. I mean, I guess at some point, any child of a physician can probably say that their parents assume that they're going to be a doctor, too, right?
True, yeah.
And so I think that assumption just kind of went with, we had it. Anyway, I applied. I still remember the day that I got the acceptance, and I told my dad. He was floored.
Were you face to face with him?
Yeah, I that was when, you know, we were getting acceptances online.
Okay.
And so I had an email while I was brushing my teeth. I remember it so well. And we were so excited, but there was a moment where it sunk in that, like, this means I'm moving.
Yeah.
I'm leaving home. I'm like leaving my family. I'm leaving the place, the one place that I grew up my entire life. And I was already engaged at that point. So I knew, like, I'm not coming back home. That's hard.
I'm sure there was a mixed feeling of excitement and fear.
Absolutely.
And, this is part of life is, you know, going to the unknown, right? And building your own brand, your own self. But I feel like everybody's journey is different. Like, you staying with your family for these 4 years have made you who you are.
Absolutely.
And there is no right or wrong in the mix, right? You use what you have and move it forward. Now, you are at MIT now. How did you major in? Like, you choose chemical engineering, right?
Right.
Can you walk us through how did you choose the major? Is there a sub-major? The experience with the professors?
Absolutely.
How was that?
So I had pursued chemical engineering in college. Mm-hmm. And you'll be surprised. The main reason that I pursued chemical engineering when I first started college was that apparently it has a very high acceptance rate into medical school. So incidentally, that's how I started, you know, with this idea that I'm
going to... as a chemical engineer or just... The from Boston as a chemical engineer.
No, that's why I pursued chemical engineering to start my education, because it had a high rate of acceptance into medical school. You know, things happened. I was good at it. I liked it.
Yeah.
I pursued chemical engineering practice at MIT, and as a part of that program, we don't have a thesis. It's two internships as a part of your degree. And what was really valuable to me around that was when I graduated college in 2008, that was when... The market turned down.
I remember that, yes.
It was not a great time to look for a job.
Yes.
It was a tough moment.
Yeah.
So I was glad that I had, you know, I planned to pursue a master's degree at that stage. But those two internships were particularly valuable to me because I had spent most of my time, all of my time, in classes, academics, learning, and not any time doing internships, doing at a company. And so I spent time at Novartis and NREL, National Renewable Energy Lab, as a part of my master's degree. And of course, I took some amazing classes with professors and colleagues, or I guess at that time they were my peers, that have done some of the most amazing things today. And I'm still in touch with many of them and excited to see the types of things they're pursuing.
That's amazing. I have a guest who's going to be coming next few episodes who talked about how the experience in colleges are different. And she's an MIT grad. And when I talked to her about MIT and other cities, she says the further you go from MIT, the more you appreciate the city and the university. So my last episode was with Dina Sharif. She works at MIT in innovation. And when I walked, this was my first time at MIT. And when I walked in the streets, the energy, the people, I mean, the place is magical.
Yeah.
Could you give us a glimpse of how that place, the professors, the innovation, what makes it different? And how was it, how did it fuel this energy to make you pursue your next step going to the PhD program?
I think I've heard a stat about Boston that it's the highest density of higher education institutions than anywhere in the world. And I could be wrong. It could be, that might be superlative, but it's close enough. Truly, that city has folks, some of the most intelligent people, some of the most curious people, people interested in making a difference, people interested in learning, come together in that city at, you know, obviously some of the best institutions in the world. Pair that with professors and resources like those that MIT, Harvard, Northeastern, BU, all of these universities have to offer. Mm-hmm. And the result, I mean, the result is obvious, right? We see the result. A lot of the innovation that I see in my work today, I'm sure that you see in your work today, has come from Boston, from different universities in the area. But there is, I think, this baseline question everything. Mm-hmm. And that's something that I think stuck with me a little bit. I try to remember that some moments when I have assumptions that I'm running with at work, you know, question everything. There is nothing guaranteed. You don't know anything for sure. But that perspective that existed when I was in school in Boston forces you to ask why. Why is it this way? And everyone's interested in having that conversation with you. Why is it that way? Why do you think that it is this? Why isn't, you know, it's something else? And so, yeah, I mean, you just said Boston is magical. It's just kind of that spot. It's one of my favorite places in the country, for sure.
Every time I go to the city, I really like, I couldn't spend more time my last visit, but every time I go, it's a magical place. Now, it always come to my mind is, sometimes you have this conviction of, okay, this is a solid state of behavior and something I want to pursue, but then is actually feeling, vulnerable and questioning is actually building block of positive behaviors. I know you didn't always have that, but how did academia, especially in graduate school, help you feel okay to question things, whether in personal or professional life?
I think, as you mentioned, every step in my career has been adding to that. Whatever I have today with me, I collected along the way. Mm-hmm. But that piece that you're talking about specifically really started when I started my doctorate.
Okay.
I think I still was a lot of pursuit of education up until MIT. And when I moved into doing my doctorate, that was really where I got to apply all these things that I've learned now. How do you take a problem that nobody has solved? Mm-hmm. And solve it. I remember the first day there, I thinking, so we're going to try to answer a question that literally nobody has ever answered, but people research it all the time. It was this concept of research, and that was the first time I started to understand what does research mean. And so 5 years of that, 5 years later, you become okay with not knowing, you know, because nobody knows.
Yeah. A lot of PhD students, when I ask about their experience, they take a sigh and say, I made the wrong decision. But once they graduate, of course, they're happy.
Sure.
And the reason I believe, I haven't done PhD, but what I hear from them is, it's a constant challenge.
Yes.
Can you talk about that? What? Why PhD students during their time doing the PhD, it's like the hardest thing ever, but once it's done, it's like they can relate to looking bad at experience and they're glad they have done it.
Yeah. I think one of them is just, you can understand when you're doing research, there are a lot of negative results that you get before you get a positive result. And what I mean is you'll have a hypothesis. You will never be able to prove it right until you do. All of those things that you didn't prove are not always publishable. And that's a huge amount of pressure as a PhD student. If you, I'm not saying that that's not valuable in the pursuit of knowledge and the pursuit of answering this question. It is, and it's necessary. But those are not your metrics. It's, your metrics are how many papers have you published. That's very hard when you put that up against what the pursuit of science actually looks like. You know, for every one paper that I published, probably 4 or 5 papers worth of experiments and research that I did that did not rise to the occasion of being published.
Interesting.
That's why.
Okay.
That's a big part of why I think it's very hard. That being said, I was in a really exceptional program. My PI, my peers were so fantastic that pressure to publish never felt like it competed with the pursuit of science. And I won't say that that's true for everybody. But it was true for me, and I was really fortunate that was the case because it allowed me to learn and grow along the way without feeling that, you know, impending doom.
There's a lot of pressure on professors. I know there are a couple of cases recently in the news about universities pushing PhD students and professors to just publish as much research
Absolutely.
As possible. And with the point you mentioned, which is, you actually need to produce something that has value and contribute to the cause you are working for. Now, I want to relate this research to the first experience you had through the working at the National Renewable Energy Lab. What did that experience mean to you? How was working there with all the fellows and researchers? Just tell me about the experience.
Oh, man, I remember it so vividly. So NREL is in Golden, Colorado.
Okay.
And so...
Beautiful place.
Beautiful place.
Yeah.
I was in Boston for, you know, 9, 8, 9, 10 months, did all my coursework, and now I uprooted and I moved to Colorado for a couple of months for this internship.
Nice.
And, again, this was the first time. Now, I'm doing my master's degree. First time you gave me a research project, a problem that nobody solved that now I'm supposed to solve. I had not yet, obviously, done my PhD.
Yeah.
And I remember first thinking, where do I even start? What do you mean? Like, I'm supposed to figure this out. I don't know how to answer questions. I know how to answer textbook questions with formulas and equations. And, you know, there's a correct answer that you circle at the end. That's not this. Where do I even begin? And, you know, that particular project that we worked on was on lignocellulosic biomass and the characteristics of that biomass that would translate into characteristics of the biofuel that came out at the other side of after a transesterification. And so there was a lot of modeling. We did a lot in MATLAB, which thankfully I had learned MATLAB at some point across the way. Yes, I did pick up some programming skills.
I did work on it a while, and it's, man.
Yeah, I mean, I learned
some. It takes time.
Exactly. Those are. I'm so glad that I did those courses, though, because it was very useful at that moment.
Absolutely.
But there were a lot of wrong answers, a lot of failed models. But it was during that time that I started to understand, how do you even look up information online? You know, how do you ask a question to the internet? The internet is a really powerful tool, and any PhD student will tell you, Google is your best friend when you're starting any kind of a research question. You have to find out what's been done, what do we already know for certain, what are the things we're still questioning, and what is totally white space, we don't know anything about it. And you learn how to use Google Scholar that has all the academic publications. That's really when I learned how to do all of those things with this problem, because now I was being put into a situation where I didn't know anything. Nobody had the correct answer. And I think at that time I may have reached out to a professor whose paper that I had read that was very similar to the work that I was doing. And I just reached out to him. He responded to me and he sent me his model.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, he's still in my LinkedIn, and I remember that very much. It was a professor from India, and he sent me his model, and that was like a very, for me.
Were you shocked that actually somebody?
Yes, yeah. For me personally, it was a groundbreaking moment, because I thought, there is an understood brother and sisterhood between people who are answering these difficult questions.
Well, somebody you have never met.
Never even spoke to on the phone. I just sent him an email, and he sent me his model. And that was very helpful for us because it helped us understand where we were, what we were missing, what we needed to add, you know, all of those pieces. But that was really when I started to understand what is research and why do we do it? And what value does it have, not just to me as an individual, but also, you know, to whatever question that we're answering.
I'm so glad you mentioned that example. I have a couple of follow-ups here. So would you consider this was the pivotal internship that actually spurred your interest on renewable energy and the environment?
Absolutely, 100%. I think it was very informative for me in my pursuit of sustainability and climate, where my work is today. Mm-hmm. But also just research and open-ended questions. I didn't know how exciting that process could be until I experienced it there.
Interesting. Now, another something that I applaud you for, reaching out to people. I think all of us have this anxiety of reaching out cold to anybody who we don't know. How did you process the thought of, okay, I'm working in a model, then looking somebody up in the internet who wasn't in the same field, then reaching out to them. Have you done this before? Or it was necessity because you had no idea?
Yeah. Back against the wall, we had to do it.
Oh, wow.
And I think, in an email, I felt like I could do it. You know, at that point, I didn't know what I know now.
And you didn't expect anything.
I didn't know. I was like, I'm just going to write this email. Maybe somebody will receive it. Maybe. And I did. But it's funny, you mentioned people have anxiety. You cold called me on LinkedIn, right?
I did, yes.
And I will say, I have cold called people in LinkedIn. My old boss, I cold called him on LinkedIn. And he reached out, and, you know, I worked with him for so many years, and we're still in touch today. I learned so much from him.
That's why I love LinkedIn.
I love LinkedIn. Big takeaway for any young people listening, invest your time in LinkedIn.
Absolutely.
And cold call people. The worst thing that can happen, they will not respond.
Which happened to me a lot.
Of course. Right? It happens to me a lot.
Exactly.
It's
It's okay. People are busy.
Yes.
It's the wrong time. It's not our responsibility to figure out, you know, if they say yes or no. We try.
Yes.
And if it works, it works. I remember reaching out to James Mousen when I was a graduate student. He was in London. They had this event in Houston for the first time, and the ticket is $8,000. And I did not have that money as a student. Cold reached out to him, cold, and he sent me a ticket. And I asked him if I can volunteer.
Wow.
He just sent me a ticket, say, hey, reach out to this person, see if you can help them out. And, you know, I knew that moment, the value of reaching out to people, because a lot of people are actually wanting to help.
I agree.
Wanted to pay back. And I think all of us, we got help from many people that at a certain point, we need to pay back by teaching the young generation, because we have huge challenges and we're going to touch base on in a little bit. I know we talked about this aspect of the difference in education levels, but let's talk about there is no formula for success. Like, we cannot copy. Like. Mm-hmm. Our circumstances are different than our kids, right?
For
Not
sure.
only the time is different, but the way they grow up is different. I mean, many factors get into this. So there's no cookie cutter, right? But how do we have to frame this with emerging technologies like AI, the world is virtual reality? How do you think about this in the context of, preparing the next generation for these tools and what's to come with the challenges as well?
You know, you're so right. We don't have any formula for success. I would not have envisioned 10, 15, or 20 years ago that somebody would reach out to me and would want to have a podcast with me. I would never have dreamt in my wildest dreams that that would happen. But I do feel like I have had, you know, and I'm so thankful to God for that, all the success that I have had personally and professionally, and I know a big part of that has been my family. But you know, you mentioned all of these other tools that are going to come, and like, what role is it going to play in our children's success? I have no idea. I can tell you that. I have no clue. We have this running sheet at my work where we talk about what are the AI tools that we can use in our day jobs to help make our day easier to learn more. Because I've used ChatGPT just like everybody else. So far, the highest value use I've seen for ChatGPT for me has been putting together a vacation itinerary for a specific location. My husband and I have done that a couple of times now. But like, it's a really powerful tool, and it's only as powerful as the user. That's what I think I've learned the most about ChatGPT.
I agree with that.
Yeah, like, prompt engineering.
Prompt engineering. It's like, what do you tell it to do? And the more information you put and the control of the pivot points within the...
Absolutely.
It will give you what you put in,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, back in school, we used to say garbage in, garbage out.
Yeah.
If you have a model and you put bad data into it, you're just going to get garbage on the other side.
Yes, I agree.
ChatGPT is very similar. Garbage in, garbage out. So whatever you give it, you will receive. And so... I think what's going to be important for our children's success and for the future generation's success is understanding how to leverage these tools, hopefully in a way better than I can today, because I can say I do not have a good grasp on, you know, AI. I think ChatGPT is a very accessible use of AI in terms of what makes it so powerful is I, as an average user with no experience, can use it. But let's like take that one step further. What if I did have some background in how to use AI as a tool to solve the challenges that I'm after in my own work and the things that I'm passionate about? I work on climate and sustainability. Mm-hmm. The use of AI to solve climate and sustainability challenges, like that's so exciting. And that's not just for this field, but all fields of science, all fields everywhere.
Everywhere.
I mean, it is mind-boggling what we can do. And so I am sure that our kids will be much more well-versed than we were. I mean, kids are already more well-versed in some social media things than I am today. And I thought that I'm keeping up, but I can't even keep up. But if you ask my parents, you know, LinkedIn, what is this? I don't need LinkedIn, right? So it changes at every generation.
It does. And I think my son now is challenging me with a new thing.
Exactly.
Like, at your age, I had no idea. Now, when I think about all of this advancement, what comes to mind is growing up, there was no cell phones.
Yep.
So when you meet someone, you had to tell him 5 o'clock Thursday, we're meeting here. And people usually are late, and if you got lucky, well, it's going to work out. With the advancement of where we are today, I know when Google came out, schools were fighting, don't use Google, you know, it's not real science. Then Wikipedia came out, and people were, don't use Wikipedia, like ChatGPT, the same thing.
I love Wikipedia. I just
got
to say.
Me too. But, the guy who created it is a genius, I think. I remember when we had wiki papers and CDs, right? But this thing is just totally different levels. I mean, you can cross-reference and everything.
It's crazy, yeah.
It's just nice. But what I was going to with, I remember a friend of mine, from Nigeria, I worked with me in Schlumberger, and he told me he used to go to a different city to pick up a book so he can use it in his research in undergrad. Looking at how we are moving so fast in this area, there is so much to think about in terms of education, culture preservation, while raising our kids. I know you had your own journey with, you know, wearing a ridah or, you know, that Eid incident. Can you talk about how do we, you know, think about this, or you think about this in terms of your kids and why culture and background is something you want to preserve?
Anna mentioned that when I was growing up, I didn't understand that what I brought to the table was special. It took me a long time to figure that out. And once I did figure that out, it gave me a lot of self-confidence, and it gave me, it made me appreciate all the things that had made me, including my culture, including my faith, including my dress, my education. And it's something that my husband and I now work on in our children much earlier than I think I didn't know that I needed to when I was a child. And You know, we talked also about the value of culture and these different perspectives and innovation and breaking the new, learning the new. And so for all those reasons why, when my husband and I talk about our children today, when we think about what are the things we want them to carry with them forward, their culture, their faith, very high on that list. Mm-hmm. Because I know that being steadfast in those things for me has been so valuable for me in my career. It's always been a steady, you know, the thing that's always there. And it helps you ground you to realize all the other things that I have, whether it's a job or a house, or those are things. This is truly who I am and where
values.
I am. Value. These are my values. And when I realized the value of those values for myself, I want my children to also feel that. Because that's really what I realize now is where my confidence came from.
Yeah.
It took me a long time to figure that out.
I see your point.
It took me a really long time to understand that now that I know that these are special to me, that's what makes me me. Everything else, you know, it comes easier.
I think I've went through the same experience, and I think those are the foundation you can build everything on.
Absolutely.
And if you lack those, some hard times comes in life where you might lose the light.
Yep.
And you'll be in a dark place, and you don't have the right tools, you know, to help you, guide you through the way. So I think we know these are important. We want to teach our kids those,
yeah,
because we know when we were 14, like, yeah, your story. I don't want to touch base with your story. So tell me a story when you, there was Eid and
yeah. Well, when I was a kid,
yeah,
I don't remember how old, I was young, but I remember it was Eid. And so we'd, you know, finished all of our roza, we'd finished namaz, we did all of our, the things that we needed to do for Eid, and now it was party time,
yeah,
fun times. Wanted to go see a movie. I remember that, I don't know, maybe my parents, my cousins, folks older with us, that were with us older, were going to come to watch the movie in Arida, in this type of a dress.
Yeah.
And I remember thinking, well, I can't go with them. That's crazy.
Yeah.
We can't go to the movies like dressed like this. And I don't think I understood, you know, that was a moment where I didn't understand the value of my values. I didn't understand the value of my culture, of my faith. I didn't know what it brought for me. Now, all these years later, you know, as an adult with this appreciation of where I come from and who I am, I want my children to feel that.
Mm.
Because I think what you said is right. When you have nothing, because we all feel that, we will all face those low moments.
Oh, absolutely, yes.
But these values, this faith, and my faith and my culture, those will stay with me. And those are the ones that are going to carry you through those moments.
Yes.
But because I have those, I have those things that are really important to me, I know that it will be okay. We will figure it out.
Yes.
And we will get to the next thing.
I know at the certain moment in college, you had to wear the redot too again, and I think having this safe space, parents need to give their kids a safe space to see a different perspective, and with the same token, allow them to grow, because you cannot force growth, right?
For sure.
Everybody's journey is different. Now, and shaping the mentality and the culture role in that is, when you speak a different language, do you visit Pakistan?
I did
you
visit
did.
Pakistan a lot when my parents were alive, yeah.
So I'm sure you understand this. When you speak two languages, sometimes you cannot express certain thoughts in the other language or vice versa. And you feel like you actually learning more by learning another language, whether the science is different or translation is not available. Your experience being from Pakistani heritage, but you were born in the U.S., I'm sure your challenges are different than a Pakistani lady who just moved in.
For sure.
Can you shed light on those factors that shapes somebody's behavior and how you had an edge dealing with challenges in the corporate world or in college compared to somebody who is not born here because you had a better language or better understanding of the culture?
That's a tough question. So, yeah, in college, I decided I was going to wear a rida, and I think, you know, it was a collection of a lot of things that finally got me to that moment where I could, where I had that confidence, I had an appreciation for my values and understood, you know, who I was. I can absolutely say that in that moment, I know how lucky I am to have been in that position, because, like you said, an immigrant who moves here doesn't necessarily feel like an American.
True.
Right? From day one, you are an immigrant, you can understand.
I understand.
It took a while for that feeling to sink
time,
in.
Yeah.
I grew up with that feeling, right? I only ever knew this place as home. And so, yes, you're right. When as the time has gone on, that has been obviously valuable for me. My command of the English language, as an example, is different than somebody who's who may have immigrated here more recently. However, somebody who comes from a different background, a different place, brings so much more. I mean, that individual is learning English. You already know that person knows two languages for sure.
True.
And probably more, because most places in the world speak more than one language, except probably us here in the States. But the background, the experiences they bring, the things they have seen, I have been one that has not recognized the value of that earlier on. Today, I understand that huge value. You said it. H-1B is the United States' most powerful tool.
Oh, absolutely.
It's true. I mean, the way people are educated across the country, the world, is different than here. It's a different way of thinking. It's how you solve problems, right? You bring different perspectives together. Two, every place in the world has different challenges. I mean, even climate and sustainability, I only know the problems that we face here in the United States. But globally, that looks very different.
It does.
Whether it's the grid, whether it's fuels, whether it's buildings or cars or infrastructure. Pollution.
Yeah.
It looks all very different. And so, sure, maybe in some ways I had an edge because I spoke English better, but I would never say that I brought something more or to the table than somebody else. I think what has obviously given me confidence is that we all bring something special.
Yes.
And so I can recognize that, you know, every person that comes to the table brings something special.
I think this is a very easy thing to understand, but it's very hard to apply, and it's very crucial to reach to is every person brings value to the table. And it is on the interest of everyone to have the confidence and humility to say, we all can share our knowledge, we can all can learn from each other, and at the end, what comes out of if we all better off, whether in our careers or our science. I did research sometimes, there was competition between two professors, which is normal, right? But what I'm saying is we need to come to terms as diversity is our strength.
Absolutely.
Right?
And 100%.
This is something we need to cherish and bring more. And I am glad Houston is one of the most diverse cities in the U.S., but I believe there's more work need to be done in terms of integrating more minorities in the workforce. Now, talking about sharing your thoughts on the balance between faith and compromise, I think this is a point very important through your journey. A lot of women and men struggle coming from a different culture in that perspective. What's your thoughts on that?
You know, I know that I come from a place of privilege when I can say that I don't want to compromise my faith to, you know, in service of any other goals. And I know that it's hard, that conversation is hard for everybody.
Absolutely.
Because what you have in front of you, you know, it matters, right? Like if I am hard pressed for a job and I have no money to eat, and the only way that X individual would be able to get such a job would be to leave something of their faith behind.
Or change their name.
How do you resolve something like that? Mm-hmm. I don't know what I would do in that moment, but I know that for me, I have been fortunate to be able to keep my faith uncompromised. And I think a big part of that is it's a sense of security and safety for myself. But also, you know, we've talked a lot about the pursuit of knowledge and the pursuit of education and curiosity. Honestly, I love the comfort zone. I will say that about myself. I love my comfort zone. Mm. I think maybe my faith for me is my comfort zone. Mm. I feel safe with it. But also, because I'm in this moment where I can say that my faith and my culture has been so valuable to me, I also know that it brings value to the table. And so don't feel like the only step you have is to leave it behind. Mm. I would say in most, if not all, cases, who you are does bring something new to the table. So yes. Bring it. Don't leave it behind. Don't hide it. I love to share, my background, who I am, where I come from with my peers and my friends and people I meet. And I want to hear from them. I want to hear about what makes them who they are, what their background is, what their faith is, with their culture, their language, their food. I think those are all the most interesting parts of, what we have of each other.
Yes. I think you touched on a very important point, which is we all have challenges sometimes in the way people look at us or put us in boxes. What makes this worse for people who come abroad is the fear pushes them to the corner. So when you are in the corner, everybody will look at you saying, that is the person in the corner. So the initial fear of communicating will be amplified. I think if we're having the right communication skills to overcome those challenges and engaging with the other, whoever that might other be, can actually improve relationships. I know with Arida you have faced certain moments. How can you help those who come from abroad, who look different, who wear different, navigate this area? And maybe if you have an example you want to talk, if you want to talk about.
Okay, I'll speak more from the, as professionally, because I think it's easier from that perspective.
Yes.
So whenever I do a talk or whenever I have to, get in front of a bunch of people to say something, I have a couple of lines that I know resonate with, they come naturally to me. Mm-hmm. They resonate with who I am. Find those lines for yourself. Like, know what those are, practice them. Because they're mostly, you're going to say them in front of different audiences. It's not going to be a problem to rinse and repeat. It helps. It helps make it easier because those are familiar words to you, and they can break the ice.
That is key.
For example, what we talked about today, the fear of asking questions, like, I know that about me, and that's something that I've used in many, many conversations that I've had about many interviews, I'll say. What have I learned doing a PhD? It's the ability to ask a question, the ability to answer questions. Mm. But anyway, those are, have those in your back pocket. That very much helps. A second might be, if you do have a fear of speaking in front of others, which I think is, very valuable skill, like generally public speaking, take a Toastmasters class. I took one back in high school. Some of those skills still sit with me today. I really learned a lot in that class, and I wouldn't have expected it to have stuck with me so long, but just the other day my husband and I were talking about taking another Toastmasters class because I just felt like it was so useful. And so that might be kind of number two. The third is understand what it is about you, who you are, and what you bring to the table that does have value in the thing that you're interested in.
Yeah.
For example, my work, my passion is really climate and sustainability. I think about these topics all the time. I love working on this challenge. And then I think, what do I bring to the table? I think about what the educational background that I might bring, which is unique, a very science, a very analytical, a very technical perspective. And I think about my parents' background, where they came from, understanding some of the global challenges that climate change will bring, whether it's food insecurity, whether it's unbearable heat, natural disasters. But I bring those things to the table. Somebody else, for example, who works in policy, understands the policy implications needed for climate change. Somebody else who maybe comes from a marketing background, understands how to get people to change their behavior, understands how to tell them a narrative. So understand what it is that you bring to the challenge that you want to work on. I know that's easier said than done. When you write a college application, they ask you to write an essay about something you're passionate about. No 17-year-old understands your passion. Exactly. I wish somebody would have told me when I was 17 that your passion is going to be climate sustainability, because that essay would have been a lot easier to write. But, you know, take the steps to figure that out.
I think the hardest thing you mentioned is the first step.
Yeah.
And once, just write something, right? Talk about something, start something, and it's a chain reaction.
Yep, absolutely.
Yeah, whenever you start the first thought, you know, then you need to hit the brake to stop those thoughts, right? It brings a very valid point to our next question that got to do with culture. So for those who don't know, you are from the cultural background as part of the Bohra Shia community. So how did the, by the way, you are the first Bohra I met. So I knew the community. I just never met anybody. And look at me meeting the first Bohra and having an interview. So you're part of this community. How did this community shape your identity and your choices in life?
Education has been, as I mentioned earlier, like a huge part of like my community and for me personally. And I think that's like number one. The value of education in our community is very high. Mm-hmm. And so I know in some parts of the world, education, especially education for women, isn't necessarily prioritized. Mm-hmm. But that has always been highly prioritized in our community. And I think a big part of why I got to where I am today. And the second is the folks in our community are not just giving.
Supportive.
So supportive and honestly so successful across the board. And they're generous with their time and their knowledge and their backgrounds. And those, I think, are two of the biggest reasons why I've seen. And, you know, I don't want to dive too deep into faith, but our spiritual leader, I was saying that, has, you know, been a guiding light for all of us in making that happen.
A lot of thinkers believe attached in culture might drive us in conflicts. Can you talk about the message of Sayyidina and what he thinks of? Is culture and religion in conflict with the world and the career? And
I would hope that at least I can say for me, absolutely not. And I think our Sayyidina has always communicated to us that these two things can exist in harmony. But, you know, we all prioritize. I know what my priorities are, and that's really been what has helped me define success for me moving forward. But, yes, I know. In fact, I would say there are plenty of folks out there that think that it's hard to be a scientist and have a strong faith. I don't think that's true. I don't think at all that my science background and my science skill sets are in any way in conflict with my faith. In fact, I think it makes it that much stronger.
I mean, for those who doubt, look at your background, your education, where you are today, and I think you're a great example for anybody to be who they want to be.
I hope so.
I wanted to touch base on, so you're moving to Boston, you graduated from IT, what's next?
I got married. Okay. I took a year off. I caught up
you
on
took
life.
A year off.
I took a year off. I caught up on life. I got married. My husband was an intern. And so we moved to San Antonio, where he was doing his internship for a year. Mm-hmm. I remember that year very well. I watched a lot of TV.
Okay.
I took on a couple of small roles just to learn. And I read a lot on different topics. And that's when I kind of decided, you know, I'm going to want to do a PhD. That, as I mentioned earlier, that experience that I had at NREL kind of clearly sparked something, because I didn't know that I would have had that pursuit had you asked me even a few years earlier. But it's the year that I made the decision that, okay, I think it's time for me to go back to school. I think there's still more for me to learn, and there's still more for me to grow, honestly. There's more that I need to learn about myself before I, you know, get a job and move on to that path. And so I got married, I did all these things, I built a life, and I started my doctorate, and it was awesome.
That's awesome. Now, I know during that journey, so your husband got accepted in New England, and for you, you didn't want, you thought it was a limiting factor in the beginning.
Yeah.
How do you think of, okay, I need to make the best of what I have, and it turned out to be a great opportunity?
Oh, man. When someone's listening back to this, especially my husband, he's not going to love to hear that. So he knows. When he did his residency in Massachusetts, and in Western Massachusetts, and when we were moving to that part of the country, I thought, now what? You know, okay, I want to do this doctorate. Like, where am I going to go? And so I applied to all the schools that I could successfully drive at so that my husband and I could both make it. You know, it was probably about 5 or 6 schools at the time. And I got accepted to Yale for my PhD. Little did I know, like, I could not have asked for the better place for me. For me, coming from the background that I did come from and what I wanted to achieve, I didn't know that at the time. I did think of it as a limiting factor. I was definitely wrong. I think that my life went that direction was my lucky stars that happened that way. My program was, first of all, opened my eyes to this entire field of study that I knew nothing about, and really broadened my view to understand, you know, environmental sustainability, climate, and, you know, the energy water nexus, SDGs, all of these terms that I'd heard floating around. I didn't understand them until I got there. My PI, my peers, they were so valuable for me, taught me so much. So I'm really thankful that I had that chance to go there.
I remembered a point I wanted to ask earlier, but I forgot. So your primary investigator, you know, have this idea of telling you, okay, you need to do this and that, but then you realize PhD is not about, you know, just taking something, knowing how to solve it and solve it, right? I liked your word when you said it's having the right tools to investigate. So if somebody asks you a question, you might not have the answer, but in your words, you said you have the right tools to get to the right answer. For people who have not done PhD, what does this mean, and how they should look at it if they want to pursue a PhD?
Absolutely. So when you start a doctorate, you have some research question in front of you, whether it's something that you have come to the table with or whether it's something that your PI is investigating broadly. I think the hardest part about it is, up until that point when you do things via a textbook, there is a right answer in the back of the book that you circle, and that's the right answer. When you do a PhD, that is not the case. There is nobody knows the right answer yet. Mm. That's what you're trying to figure out. And you can gather those tools. You can learn from people who have solved similar problems, from adjacent industries or adjacent topics that have, you know, had this challenge but different application, through reading, through your peers' research, through your PI's research. And so that's really what a PhD is. It is learning how to learn about something that you don't know anything about. And then, you know, gathering those tools, like you mentioned, so that you can answer the question in front of you. And, like, I think back, my PI, Julie, I hope she one day watches this. She taught me so much about how to ask those questions and how to answer those questions. And so a lot of the tools that I picked up during that time were really valuable to me, and I still use them today.
That's amazing. And I think this is spot on for the challenges we face today in the world. I do remember... So my background is petroleum engineering, and I picked it up because oil was the only commodity where I grew up. Right? So I had fun in doing APA program, academic program abroad, and one program I did was in Alaska. So we had to spend a couple of months there. We did research in coral reefs, and we had to pick certain research. Mine was coral reefs I picked. And I learned about oil spill that happened in 1989 there. Was a concept called keystone predator, meaning if one creature dies, the creatures that feeds on him or the creatures that unbalance will change the whole environment.
Absolutely.
And we're talking about one oil spill. Today, with all these challenges, heat temperatures are rising. And for any person who doubts that, they can see the weather, the hurricanes, the floods, right? And I remember there was a model. It was NOAA Lab that we had done research in NOAA Labs, and there were only 3 labs in the U.S. that has done those temperature modeling. And I've seen a red dot in Kuwait. And so I asked a researcher, like, what does this mean? Like, in 2070, it will be very hard for people to live in this area. I was like, Kuwait? She's like, yes. So later on, I mean, that was just at that moment. Later on, when I did my master's, professor of geopolitical economy has brought in another research saying almost the same thing. To cap all of this, part of our research was to see the glacier where it was in 1957 by a metal mark. Then we walked for hours to the end of the glacier, and we measured the acceleration. So this is your specialty.
Yes.
And as a scientist, can you touch base on the changes that happens here in the US, but it's connected the whole world, especially in the places where water's gonna be scarce, Iraq, Egypt, floods in Pakistan, just the whole energy environment nexus?
Oh man, you know, those types of stories, like the one like you shared about the glacier.
Yeah.
I always feel them, you know, like climate anxiety.
Yes.
Like this like sense of doom. I'll get back to why we can't just have a doom perspective once I talk about all the negative.
Okay.
but you're right. The impacts that I think up until now, we've been talking about climate change as something that's going to happen to us at some point in the future. Mm-hmm. The future is now. The future is right now.
Yes.
It is. We are melting.
Yes.
Here. We saw wildfires in Hawaii. We saw, and wildfires in other parts of the world, Spain,
Canada,
I think parts of Greece, California, LA, where I grew up, had its first hurricane. The hurricane. So we have hurricanes because the ocean waters are warming. And in California, we have the Pacific Ocean's generally very cold.
Correct.
All of the hurricanes are where we are today in Houston because the ocean's very warm on this side. California had its first hurricane. Glacial melt in Pakistan wiped out, I don't even know the metrics, but beyond the scope of what we can think.
Wow.
Places like Kuwait will be uninhabitable. Places will find food insecurity very soon. We will see biodiverse species collapse, just like you saw happen in Alaska. All of these impacts are starting.
Yeah.
And if we don't intervene on a short time scale, they will continue to get worse. And we can already see what that's going to look like. Mm. I mean, a small anecdote. It's Houston. 30 days of over 100 degree weather.
Yeah.
That's outrageous. Even for Houston, that's
outrageous. Yes, I agree.
And what's going to happen moving forward? You know, that's not going away unless we do something about it. And so this is kind of where I get to flip to the hope side. First, if I didn't have any hope, I wouldn't be able to do the kind of things that I do today. I wouldn't be able to work in this field. And I'd say that many people that you talk to in this space would feel similarly. I mean, what we do is hope. That's what gives me hope that we can fix this. We can find cleaner ways to fuel our planet. We can conserve water. We can do more with less. And we talked a little bit about, you know, how I bring my faith into my work. A big part of our faith in general, and perhaps this resonates with you, and I think this is true, honestly, for most faiths. Do more with less. Don't waste. Use what you need. Food waste. Easy example.
Yes.
That transcends faith. Those are really core values for many people across the world. If we could embody those values, we would be able to solve some of the challenges that we face today. You know, don't leave the lights on if you don't need them.
Mm.
You know, if you can afford to ride a bike or take public transportation, choose to do that. There are small choices that we can make personally.
But collectively make a big difference.
Collectively make a big difference. And, you know, whether it's what we choose to eat, whether it's what we choose to drive, how we choose to live, you know, convenience doesn't always have to be a number one consideration. Mm. Sometimes we can make climate our primary consideration. But I think all of these things give me some hope that we can and will find a way out of this mess that we are in at the moment.
You answered a question I was about to ask, which is, we always look at, you know, big corporations, and they have their own part of, you know, the impact of climate change, but everything is connected towards the economy.
Yep.
And it serves us as people.
Absolutely.
And we can change, by changing our behavior at a smaller scale, to make this a faster recovery, hopefully. Now, this is connected to my next question. I know that a lot of viewers are going to ask this question. You're from West Coast. You lived in East Coast. This is your perspective. But I am sure because you are in Houston now, you have been exposed to the energy point of view.
Yes.
The folks who works in energy.
For sure.
Who lights everything we have here right now, who have spurred the growth for many years, although they have their part of this. But since you are in Houston now, how can you tell people from Los Angeles, people from New England, and people from Houston who have different views on this, how can we bring them together?
You know, I get asked this question, honestly, even like people that I meet. You're from California, you live in the, you've lived on the East Coast, you work in climate change, and now you live in Houston. And like, what is that like? And I'll say, for one, having lived in all these different regions has brought a lot of balance to my own views, my own perspectives. I think we tend to have a very, I don't want to say extreme because it makes it sound negative, but one-sided.
Yeah.
One-sided view depending on where we've come from, depending on, you know, I came from LA. That has a very specific point of view that I grew up with. But moving here now, it has made me understand a lot more of the pieces that go into it. Like you mentioned, oil and gas. It's a great example. I think I came to Houston with vilifying oil and gas broadly. Obviously now, having spent so many years working in this space, I recognize the challenges that the energy industry faces. And also like the huge economic and not just economic, but quality of life value that they bring across the world. There is a huge energy security conversation that we need to have. That being said, no other industry in the world is better positioned to benefit from, and when I say benefit, I mean to make money from, the energy transition and what we need to achieve to meet our climate goals than the oil and gas industry.
I agree.
The footprint, the skill set, the capital and assets, no other industry is as well positioned. And so I think this is a moment for the energy industry to take a leadership role. I think really demonstrating that this is the change that we can make in our own business. We will be the leader. We can, there is the huge first mover's advantage that exists here. Mm-hmm. And pushing the rest of the industry along with it. I think it's a moment. We're waiting to see who's it going to be. I know we've all seen some recent news, which tells us that the industry's maybe not moving in the right direction. But I still have faith and hope that, you know, somebody's going to take this market opportunity for what it is. Obviously, huge climate implications, but also, you know, this is where we are moving. Oil, solar is already cheaper than natural gas power. We already know that. And so we don't need to be making any more natural gas power plants. That's already step one. So writing is on the wall.
I've read an article about that.
Yeah, writing is on the wall. We know we can do that. So everything else is following quickly. And given the urgency behind this particular challenge we're facing, I would go as far as to say that most of the technologies that are kind of on their innovation curves are going to move even faster along that curve moving forward because we know we don't have a choice.
Yeah, we don't have a choice, yeah.
Yeah.
I do recall the first company, oil and gas company, that changed its name, Statoil.
Yeah.
So they changed it to Equinor. And when I was a student, graduate student at Rice, their chief economist spoke at the Baker Institute. And from that moment, the way BP report is very famous in the industry, but Equinor model was totally different. They did not forecast. They had different forecast. Like usually everybody just have one forecast if this happens. They had three different scenarios, and each scenario has had a different forecast.
Yep.
And it clearly they preceded everybody in the industry because the strategies they had to deal with the oil and gas. But I see your point when you say, because they have harvested today those advancements. They got into the market first.
Exactly.
And I think they announced the first solar wind farm in Northeast or in the Gulf. I forgot. But they got there first. Now they are leading the way. And this is why it's important for, you know, a lot of oil and gas companies, as you mentioned, to, you know, be at a frontier. Now, this is related to the Ph.D. and how things connect looking backward. When you mentioned you taking classes at college that didn't seem relevant at the time but became valuable later, can you share an example of one such course and how it's connected to your career?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, when I read back to this question, I thought there are actually quite a few I can think of, but the one that stands out to me is a class that I took on bubbles. I didn't have any idea what I was going to do with it when I took it. And for those that know, bubbles are mostly about boundary layers. They're about that thin layer that exists close to the surface in which the properties change, right? Things are different. The transfer of mass and heat and through those boundary layers looks very different than it does in ambient conditions. I never would have thought that those would have had so much value to me just in terms of like understanding as I do now moving forward. So now when I think about some of these major engineering challenges that we face, scale up as a great example, right? I work a lot of things that I work on now and I have for the last several years have been on innovation, new technologies to tackle climate challenges. And what scale-up means. You know, you're doing something at a small lab scale and moving it to pilot scale and then commercial scale.
Okay.
When you scale up, the size of whatever you're working on changes. Like, let's take, for example, just surface area to volume ratio is a great example here. If you have a small bubble versus a big bubble, the surface area changes, the volume changes, they don't change at the same rate. And just the understanding of what that means for boundary layer conditions also changes, right? Like what is the overall mass that has to pass through this boundary layer? As you scale up, the mass that has to transfer across the boundary layer is so much more than it was. So those conditions that maybe were true at the small scale are different now at a big scale because there's so much more mass that has to pass that boundary layer. It's just one example. And you know, I don't know if I'm doing it justice, but I will say there are some classes that stick with you. Bubbles is one of them. Another one might be separations. Didn't even understand what separations was when I took it. And when I was done, I realized we're actually talking about separating two molecules from another, two miscible fluids from each other. Obviously, huge implications today for energy industry. But I want to touch back on something that you mentioned around the oil and gas industry and why they're so well positioned. Today, the reason that our economy is so dependent on fossil fuels is because we have been so good at making money from the bottom fraction all the way to the top fraction. We know how to use every single drop and not waste a single bit of it. That's why this industry is so successful. Imagine if we brought that same perspective to clean fuels, to renewable energy. That would change the way we consider anything in the alternative fuel space.
Transition to, you know, the energy water nexus come from a lot of awareness to how big of an issue this is. It is always comes to mind the conflict between commercial legacy and pivoting towards the new transition, right?
Absolutely.
And I think in Houston, you see, I think there's like an energy transition committee. You have research from think tanks like the Baker Institute. You have a lot of conferences people focusing on. So there is initiatives.
Absolutely.
And I think we should, as a city, be on the lead of leading this transition and commercial way too. Now, so you are at Salesforce now. By the way, congratulations. You just got promoted,
Thank
I know. So you're now the director of
Climate and Energy.
Climate and Energy. So the most two important things today, right?
For me.
For the world, too. I am interested in seeing what skills do you feel like you have took from academia that serves you well today in helping you with your job?
I probably won't limit it to academia because, as we've talked about,
it's collective,
right? Yes. There are a lot of things that I brought with me. Mm-hmm. One is surely the ability to ask a question and answer a question that I don't know anything about. And I think learning how to use tools like Google and Wikipedia in my time, and probably for our kids it will be ChatGPT and other AI tools.
Yes.
But amazing. That honestly is like really valuable. That the ability, I think what the what I'm trying to say is, don't be scared by the question in front of you. There were moments when I thought, when I was at NREL, like, how do you want me to answer this? I don't even know where to start. And over time, you know, you have enough confidence in your own abilities that you can say, I can probably figure it out. I may not get 100% of the way there, but I can get a 75% of the way there. So that's probably one of the most valuable skill sets that I've had. It's just how to answer a question. It's, I wouldn't even say anything I've learned, I still use any text, something I read in a textbook, but rather how to learn, how to read. That's been really valuable for
me. So the conceptual aspect.
Absolutely. You know, there's a logic piece that's like so helpful for me today. Just understanding the way systems are connected, understanding the energy, water, food nexus, how one affects the other, why you can't solve, why it is challenging to solve both at the same time, but you certainly cannot sacrifice one for the other. Some of those concepts. That's been really valuable to me. And then we touched on public speaking, but absolutely. The ability to have a conversation, I think, is so important. Exchange of ideas.
Exchange of ideas, yeah. Now, between each function, tool, transition, you mentioned something in our conversation that I think is very pivotal, which is optimization. And I wish I knew this aspect early in my life and in my career, which is, I think it's like a lever. You push and pull and try to find a balance. So can you talk about how did you optimize in certain stages in your career or in your life, especially as a working parent? And what's your advice for working mothers and mothers who want to work?
Sure. The idea of optimization is something that I took from my engineering background. I mean, we've done it, right?
Yes.
You have to optimize for one constraint. If you're optimizing against two constraints, you've obviously, now you've got a degree of freedom that you don't know what to do with.
Yes.
And so I have realized through time that you can optimize for one thing. You can try to prioritize other things, but you can really only optimize for one. And that's okay. I think we all face at different points in our career, at different points in our life, we have to optimize for different things. I had kids starting when I was in graduate school. And so early on, there were choices that we made as a family that made the most sense because my kids were really young at the time. And at that time, it's okay to optimize for not the thing you thought you would optimize for example, career growth. Maybe that's not what you're optimizing for when you have, you know, a two-year-old and a newborn. That might not be the right time to optimize for that, and that's okay. Mm. But later in your career, if you decide to make a shift, you can optimize for something else. And that's been, I think, very leading for me. For example, when my husband wasn't in Massachusetts and doing his residency, I had to optimize for something different than what I thought I was going to optimize for. Optimize for location at that time. Worked out really well for me. You know, I was really fortunate. It worked. And at different stages of my career, I have optimized for being a parent. I have three children at home. My husband has a pretty demanding job. And so I wanted to be available. I wanted to be around. And so I optimized for working from home because that's what that's the environment that I needed. I think now at the time when thankfully things are moving well for my family and my kids are bigger, they're all in school, I'm optimizing. What I think I'd like to say is I'm optimizing for impact. You know, I feel fortunate where I am financially and, you know, with all the things that I have been given. I am optimizing for what is the biggest impact that I can leave behind in the work that I'm doing. And for me, climate and sustainability is that. And that's, I think, been a lot of the motivating factors for some of the decisions that I'm making now.
That's amazing. Now, not to get the wrong impression or idea, all the skills you have learned and accumulated through this, which made you who you are today, and you're still evolving, had to do with you making always the first step towards something different. So you started as a research assistant at UCLA, you're teaching assistant at MIT, then two externships, then you did teaching assistant at Yale, then you transitioned to finance.
Yep.
So we talked about everything up till five. So how did that happen?
Oh man, you know when you mentioned this to me that a lot of this has been about like the new thing.
Yeah.
If I were to ask myself, what am I not good at? It's new things.
Wow.
I would tell you that. I do not think of myself as somebody who goes outside of the things I know I'm good at. It's just not, it's not how I'm wired. And so when you reflect it back to me in that way, it maybe gives me a slightly different perspective on the choices that I've made. But yes, the move into finance, my PI helped me kind of break into that role. I knew that academics wasn't going to be for me. I didn't wasn't going to pursue a professorship. It wasn't the type of role I was looking for. And so she helped me become an operating advisor at a finance firm. I had no idea what I was getting myself into, I'll be totally honest. I knew science. I knew technical skills. I
could Sounds answer. Like you enjoy putting yourself somewhere.
Well, I did not think that at the time, for sure. But, that was a crash course in corporate everything. I didn't understand anything about anything before I got there. But I understood, I learned about what for companies to be successful economically, what is it that we need to look for? How does the science have to support some of those initial metrics that we're trying to go after? What is scale-up going to look like? I learned the types of questions that we need to ask, especially when we're looking at early technology.
So you were specialized in biotechnology?
I was doing sustainability-based acquisitions, just given my background. But, you know, you can ask any PhD student, when they graduate, nobody will say that they are an expert across the board. They are an expert in one thing that they published 5 papers on, and they're really good at that. That was me. I knew a lot about the one topic that I studied. Didn't have a really broad understanding at the time, but that role forced me to broaden my view quickly, understand, contextualize the work that I had done, but also all of these other technologies, understand context and scope systems in a way that I didn't understand before. And that role really helped me do that. It also helps you understand as like, somebody with a doctorate, what are the transferable skills that you're bringing?
I was about to mention this point, which is all the skills you had learned in PhD, you are using them in a different dimension.
Yes, but you don't know how to articulate that.
That's true. That is very true.
And I learned how to articulate that in that role. Such a pivotal time for me.
I was about to say, it must have been very rewarding to live the realization of if you put the tools you have built to anything you can accomplish, even the big challenges. And we are glad we have you in a position for climate and energy, because all the skills that shaped who you are really put you in a great position. And I think Salesforce is lucky to have you.
I appreciate that.
Now, Climate Impact Capital was the same, almost the same.
Actually, it was a big shift in that when I moved to Houston, I was looking for something a little closer to home and closer to the industry that we were working on, I was living in now. So at CAC, I mentioned I had cold called my old boss on LinkedIn.
Oh, that was, okay, yeah.
That's Alex at CAC. I cold called him, and you know, it was, the rest is history, but we focused very clearly on energy decarbonization. That was the goal. That was our thesis and our remit. And so, you know, up until now, I'd kind of broaden my scope from water, which is where I did my doctorate, to understand broadly where does water fit into the context of energy-water nexus, how does food and waste, and understanding how systems are impacted by each other. Mm-hmm. That's what I learned when I graduated from my doctorate in my first role. When I moved to CAC, now it's unpacking. Energy is not just gas in my car. Energy is so much more than that. Energy is not just like flipping the lights on, but how do all of these different forms of energies work with each other? Where do they come from? Where can we find synergies for innovation, where one solution can support another? Where do we have to continue to innovate? The depth of knowledge that I got in that role from Alex especially was beyond what I would have ever expected.
So it was a different value add.
Absolutely. So it was so great. I was so hands-on to the work that I got to do, and I learned so much.
So you're at Salesforce today.
Yep.
You finally feel like after all these studies, all this experience, you finally feel like now it is.
It makes sense. I figured it out.
How?
I have no idea. I have no idea. I feel so fortunate that all these things, all the way starting back when I did that separations course at UCLA and NREL and the bubbles class and my doctorate, all those things that I brought together, I understand how they all fit into this big picture and what I need to be doing in the context of that big picture. It took me so long to figure it out.
I think everybody has this idea of there's something missing, but Identity Capital as a podcast is coming from this idea of what are the assets everybody built as they grow up, and everybody's different.
Yeah, for sure.
That eventually makes them who they are, which you are a great example of, that if somebody looks or listens to this, that might have an idea of their journey, not yours, because everybody's journey is different. Now, how do you see the interconnectedness of sustainability challenges such as the water energy nexus influencing humanity in the future, and why it is very crucial for all of us as humans to work together, because this is a serious threat?
Absolutely. And I mentioned that it took me so long to fit all the pieces together, you know, to understand what is it that is in front of me? What are all the parts of this problem? Mm-hmm. One of the pieces that I don't think we got to talk about is the part that maybe I brought to it that was different, right? Is where I come from, where my parents come from, where's the background that I come from? And, you know, over the course of time with my parents and now with my own family, we travel a lot. We get to see different parts of the world. I have seen how climate change can impact not just us here in the United States, you know, 100 degree weather in Houston, but other parts of the world where they will feel food. They already do feel food insecurity. Places are becoming uninhabitable. This is a global challenge. Mm-hmm. And I think some would say perhaps our share here in the States is a lot bigger than everywhere else.
Yeah.
And so that onus, it does sit with us. Like, you know, this is where the money sits. This is where the money is, right, in the United States.
Correct.
And we are honestly one of the largest contributors to global climate change broadly. And so we're never going to solve the problem. We made the problem by prioritizing ourselves. We are not going to solve the problem by prioritizing only ourselves.
Correct.
It's just not going to happen. We've already talked about the interconnectedness of the energy water nexus. You can't sacrifice one solution for another.
Yeah.
The same is true when we're solving climate change. We cannot do this without remembering the interconnectedness of what we do here is going to impact our, you know, our friends in Europe and our friends in Australia and in Asia and in Africa. We have to work collaboratively in order to achieve any of the things that we want to. Probably not, I mean, yes, absolutely, climate is top of that list, but other things as well. I'm confident we can do it. I see every day the amazing people that work on this. I'm so fortunate to call them my colleagues, my peers. There are a lot of great minds working on this challenge. And so, you know, I hope something that folks on this watching this can take back with them is, like, there's a role for you too, with your skill set. Bring it to the climate challenge. We want every single person, all hands on deck. Everyone brings something unique, and we need everyone's expertise in order to solve this challenge.
I absolutely agree. Now, the last question, the identity capital question. So some lessons in life are only learned by doing, living, experiencing, and cannot learn from books. If time goes back, you are just going to college, what one lesson you wish you knew from that perspective that would have helped you or changed your life for the better early on if you knew? That the audience can learn from.
I hope I can articulate it in the right way. There are moments in your path, in your journey, that you feel like you know what needs to be done, you know the answer, you know what you bring, but you don't feel the confidence in order to demonstrate that to the world yet. What I will say is, even if you don't think you're ready yet, act like it. Because if you don't take yourself seriously, nobody will take you seriously. And that's actually something that I feel like I've learned very late in life. But if you don't believe in what you're selling, nobody else is going to buy it. And I think today, now, I can tell you, like, I believe what I'm selling when I talk about climate and sustainability, which is why I feel so passionately about it, not just in my professional life, but in my personal life also. But if you don't believe in what you're selling the wrong thing. Sell something else. Find what it is that you believe in. because that's what makes you special, right? I can sell a lot of things. I could take my skill set and go somewhere else, and you know, I'm sure I'll make a great living. But that's not what I necessarily believe in. So how will I ever find success in that space? So that's probably my one thing I'd say. Find it is what you believe in, and then sell that.
I love this message, and I wish I knew it back in the day. Jamila, thank you so much for your time.
You.
This was Identity Capital. Thank you for tuning in.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Appreciate it.